TV meteorologist in Rochester, New York, who lost his job.
I know what you're doing. You're looking for the right podcast. You're looking for something that's intriguing, interesting, and incredible. You're looking for something that gets you away from the politics and hot-button current affairs. You're looking for something else. Well, you've come to the right place. I'm PJ, and welcome to my corner of the world. On August 12th, the town of Dyersville, Iowa hosted the state's first Major League Baseball game. Just a few corn lengths away from the original site of the 1989 Academy Award Best Picture, Field of Dreams. MLB built it, and they came. The starring team in the film, an AL Central Division champion Chicago White Sox, the New York Yankees, the MLB on Fox crew, 8,000 fans of the Southsiders or the Bronx Bombers, and of course, Kevin Costner, who led the Sox and the Yanks out of the corn in right field.
Is this heaven? I don't think I heard you. Is this heaven? Yes, it is.
Now, if you listen to the first two episodes of this podcast, you probably know that I'm not a fan of either team that took the field in this game. But honestly, you didn't need to be to thoroughly enjoy it. Not only was it an exciting back-and-forth game, but an overall incredible experience. The cinematic-style intro of Costner on both teams, American Idol Season 18 winner Maddie Pop singing the national anthem in front of Ray and Annie's farmhouse, the vintage, rustic field, the specially built ballpark, the White Sox's 1919 throwback uniforms, the hand-turned scoreboard in right field designed to look even older than the ones at Wrigley Field or Fenway Park, the scoreboard graphics on Fox even looking hand-turned, which is something I wish the Marquee Sports Network could have done for Cubs games, and the highlight of any ball game, dingers, this time into acres of corn.
Anderson hits it in the air to right, back at the wall, and the White Sox win it!
Most importantly, the Field of Dreams game served a greater purpose than keeping the Sox in first place or the Yankees in the wild card hunt. Just like in the movie, this game brought families together. Fathers taught their children the ways of the game and cheered their favorite team, while the kids put their tablets away and even had their own catch with loved ones.
Hey, Dad? You want to have a catch?
I'd like that.
The game was also received rather warmly on social media, with many looking forward to the sequel next season, this time between the winners of that tainted 1919 World Series, the Reds, and the White Sox's rivals from Wrigleyville, the Cubs. But almost immediately after Tim Anderson's walk-off homer into the corn to give the Sox a 9-8 victory, fans began yearning for another film to get its own game. A film that features the Yankees as part of its biggest plotline, and also has James Earl Jones as part of its cast. A film that didn't win any awards, but has become a definite favorite among many baseball fans.
You play ball like a girl!
I'm talking about The Sandlot, starring Tom Geary, Mike Vitar, Patrick Renna, Chauncey Lepardi, and more. This is the story of a group of kids in the summer of 1962, their love of the game, and their adventure with an English Mastiff. I think the Sandlot game would be a lot of fun to play and watch. It could bring players back to their own childhoods of pickup games on hot summer days. But MLB needs the right location for it. The original filming site in the Glendale neighborhood of Salt Lake City looks a lot worse for wear now than it did in the early 90s. So the league would need to do a lot of work to get a close level of quality of even a minor league ballpark. There's also the option of the Rose Park Baseball Diamond, which had been built to replicate the original field for the movie's 25th anniversary in 2013. However, that was designed for Little League games, with a lower pitcher's mound and closer outfield fence. My idea for a Sandlot game would be to have a different city hosted every year, and be part of a number of festivities the week or weekend of the 4th of July. For a couple days, MLB could host a carnival somewhere in the city, similar to where small sprints in the game go in the film, wipeout ride and all. Another day, the league could foot the bill for an open swim at a neighborhood pool, again, just like the film, minus any snot-nosed kids trying to sneak a kiss from a lifeguard giving them mouth-to-mouth.
Little pervert!
And all this would lead up to the game itself on the night of the 4th. Have the game at a neighborhood baseball field. MLB doesn't need to turn it into a full-blown ballpark with concessions, jumbotrons, and other amenities. but rather just the basics for field quality. A distant outfield fence, foul poles, the standard pitcher's mound, more lighting if needed, a basic PA system, a tarp in case of a rain delay, and perhaps a scoreboard and connection for replay review. In fact, the scoreboard doesn't need to be elaborate either. It could just be a plastic sheet that names the teams in the basic box score. Even more bare bones than the one for the Field of Dreams game. Have the game be open to the public, with either a minimal price for tickets or free of charge. Just like in that iconic scene from The Sandlot, invite the surrounding neighborhood to safely light fireworks to almost recreate that awesome visual. At the game's end, MLB could host a fireworks show of its own, complete with Ray Charles' rendition of America the Beautiful. The first two teams to play in this game should be the Dodgers and the Royals, with LA hosting. However, to go along with the hat Kenny De Nunez wore in that film, the Royals wear the uniforms of the Kansas City Monarchs of the Negro League. Of course, much more would need to be taken into consideration to make this happen, such as security, parking, seating, but this could be an event that brings the community together, boosts fan bases and viewership, and bring fans back to a simpler, more carefree time in their lives. And besides, try to imagine someone like Justin Turner seemingly hitting a home run into a sky full of fireworks. If that isn't a perfect picture of classic Americana, I don't know what is. Thank you so much for listening to this episode of My Corner of the World. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed making it happen. Let me know what you thought. Leave a comment on SoundCloud, YouTube, and other social media platforms, and watch out for more episodes to come. Until then, I'm PJ. This time, I think I'll let James Earl Jones close this one out.
The one constant through all the years, Ray, has been baseball. America has rolled by like an army of steamrollers. It's been erased like a blackboard, rebuilt and erased again. But baseball has marked the time. This field, this game, is a part of our past, Ray. It reminds us of all that once was good, and it could be again. Oh, people will come, Ray. People will most definitely come.